edges run today. All right. Opponents ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yep.
Landon and I affirm resolved. The United States should abolish the capital gains tax. Our first contention is on the economy, subpoint A, investment. As Mark Marotta writes in June of 2014, the amount of capital gains realized depends heavily on the favorability of the capital gains tax rate. As a result, over half of capital gains are never taxed. They are avoided completely. But the effort of avoiding the tax causes capital to be allocated inefficiently in the meantime. Capital gains taxes not only damage current investments, but they prevent innovation by blocking new companies from gaining the funding that they need. As Bach and Watzinger write in April of 2017, higher capital gains tax rates leads to a reduction in the number of companies receiving their first investment and lowers the probability of receiving a follow-up one. The Heritage Foundation states in October of 2001, cutting capital gains tax rates is the single best tax policy to improve economic growth. Capital gains play a unique role in fostering economic activity, especially by investors in high technology areas. In fact, many economists, including Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan, believe that the optimal tax on capital gains is 0%. Economists are clear when they speak about this tax. It is a dangerous and an unproductive drain on our economy that encourages bad investments while stifling necessary growth. The impacts of abolishing the capital gains tax are also clear. As explained by the Joint Economic Committee of the U.S. Congress in June of 1997, the taxation of capital gains discourages innovation, risk-taking, and capital investment. They find that capital gains taxation affects investment through its impact on venture capital, which is an extremely important source of funding for these projects, and thus it restricts the amount of venture capital that is available to these new firms. Subpoint B is growth. The Small Business and Entrepreneurship Council in July of 2012 writes, the capital gains tax ranks among the most destructive because it is a levy on the returns of risk-taking, that is, on the investment that drives innovation and drives growth. They find that our elected officials should be focused on reducing, or preferably eliminating, capital gains taxes. The reason for this is explained by Charles Lehman, Associate Director of Tax Policy at the Fraser Institute in 2014, saying capital gains taxes reduce the return that investors receive from the sale of a business. They find that this diminishes the reward for their risk-taking and reduces the number of entrepreneurs and investors that support them. The result is lower levels of econ growth and lower levels of job creation. Additionally, Dr. Alan Sinai, Chief Economist and Strategist for the DEE Global Research Team, finds in 2010 that reducing the capital gains tax rate to 0% increases growth in real gross domestic products by a little over 0.23 percentage points a year. Jobs increase by 1.3 million a year, the unemployment rate drops 0.7 percentage points at its lowest point, and productivity growth increases 0.5 percentage points a year. Additionally, Harvard University's Malcolm Salter finds in 2014 that reducing the capital gains tax to zero would have an increase in research and development spending by close to $8 billion over 5 years and would end up costing the federal government less than the initial static cost of the tax reduction. In fact, Strula quantifies this in May of 2012, writing that abolishing the capital gains tax would actually increase government revenue when accounting for other taxes, finding that for the tax on capital gains specifically, total tax revenues increase by 0.3 to 1.2% after abolishment of the tax. Our second and final contention is on unjust taxation. Forbes in 2015 finds, when inflation is high, the capital gain can be mostly due to it. In other words, the gain can be an illusion and the tax rate can even rise above 100%. The Tax Foundation finds in 2013 this is problematic because the capital gains tax creates a bias against saving, it slows economic growth, and places a double tax on corporate profits. The National Review quantified this by saying capital gains taxes totaled $134 billion last year, but approximately one-fourth of that revenue, or $34 billion, was generated by taxing pure inflationary gains. And finally, Carroll finds in February of 2012 that the double tax discourages capital investment and results in less capital formation. With less capital available, it reduces the wages of workers and ultimately lowers America's standard of living. For these reasons, Landon and I are proud to affirm.
Judges ready? Opponents?
Yeah.
Partner?
Yep.
Okay. My partner and I negate that resolve the United States should abolish the capital gains tax. We offer the following observation. The U.S. Internal Revenue Code states that, quote, the term ordinary income includes any gain from the sale or exchange of property which is not a capital asset, end quote. Therefore, abolishing the capital gains tax means that capital gains will not fall under the income tax, so a pro vote results in complete tax exemption for capital gains. With that, we negate for three reasons. One, disproportionate benefit to the wealthy. Two, tax shelter. And three, the harms of inequality. Our first contention is that the rich would be disproportionately benefited. Subpoint A, consolidation. Greenberg finds in February 2017 that, quote, the likely reason why the top 0.1% of households saw a slightly lower tax rate in 2014 is because a higher portion of their income consisted of long-term capital gains, which are subject to lower tax rates, end quote. This demonstrates that the already low capital gains tax rates disproportionately benefit the rich. Hungerford quantifies this disparity, finding in June of 2010 that, quote, about 90% of capital gains accruals go to households in the richest income quintile, and about 70% go to the richest 5% of households, end quote. Kinney concurs, finding in spring of 2011 that, quote, capital gains realizations are extremely consolidated in the richest quintile. Because the capital gains tax rate has historically been much lower than the wage rate, there most certainly has been greater inequality produced over time as a result, end quote. Therefore, abolishing the capital gains tax will expand the gap between the income and capital gains taxes, compounding its effect on inequality further. This prediction has been confirmed in the U.S. state of South Carolina. Subpoint B, empirical failure. The Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy found in August of 2016 that, quote, South Carolina's 44% exclusion for all long-term capital gains income drains roughly $127 million from state coffers each year while providing no benefit to the vast majority of state's residents. More than 96% of the benefits of this exclusion flow to the wealthiest 20% of South Carolinians, and 66% flow to the top 1% of earners alone, end quote. Our second contention is that abolishing the capital gains tax produces a tax shelter to the rich. Our observation of the Internal Revenue Code, Section 61, means that a pro-ballot translates to tax-exempt capital gains. This is very problematic because it provides an easy avenue for tax avoidance to the rich. Aaron from the Brookings Institute explains in October 2015 that, quote, the gap between tax rates on various forms of income encourages people to go to considerable effort and expense to convert more highly taxed wages and salaries into capital gains or dividends. Although such conversions are often costly, they are worth it, provided one has enough income to shelter. A multi-billion dollar tax planning industry thrives on fees wealthy filers willingly pay for help to do just that. Tax avoidance is quite legal, but if one is interested in boosting taxes on the rich, one would be ill-advised to encourage them to shelter more of it, end quote. Our third and final contention is that increased inequality leads to disaster. Subpoint A, quality of life. The Seven Pillars Institute finds in February 2015 that, quote, societies with pronounced economic inequality suffer from lower long-term GDP growth rates, higher crime rates, poorer public health, increased political inequality, and lower average education levels, end quote. These impacts culminate into a much more serious one. Subpoint B, mortality rate. A 2011 report from the Congressional Research Service found that a 1% increase in national capital gains income results in a 0.1% increase in the Gini coefficient, a measure of economic inequality going from 0 to 1. This impact is quantified by Zhang in 2012, writing that a, quote, a 0.01 increase in the Gini coefficient was found to increase the cumulative odds of an individual's death by 122% over a period of 12 years, and the broader pattern of the effect was found to be generally similar for all three measures of income inequality, end quote. In conjunction, these sources prove that an increase in capital gains income would greatly increase the mortality rate of the United States. Thus, we negate.
Could you repeat it? Sorry.
The answer may continue, a question may not.
All right.
And go.
Okay, Victoria, so you talk about in this first contention how it benefits the wealthy, essentially, and that ultimately it'll increase income inequality. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so why are capital gains taxes specifically the main contributor to income inequality?
So what we're seeing is, with our Hungerford card, that 90% of capital gains accruals go to households in the richest income quintile. So if you abolish the tax on those accruals, then all of the, or majority of the benefits would flow to the wealthiest percentage of Americans, and so greater income inequality would be produced as a result.
But that's not unique to just the capital gains tax, right? That's basically the entire tax system of the United States, that it's unfairly benefiting those at the very top. So why are capital gains specifically the worst out of all of them?
Our evidence doesn't say it's the worst, but what we're saying is that eliminating this specific tax would make income inequality worse,
right.
And so we shouldn't do that, obviously.
All right.
All right. I have a question regarding your second contention. You state the Strelitz card saying that if you abolish the capital gains tax, revenue would increase in other other streams of revenue would increase. How does that happen?
Sure. Basically, what allows to happen and the impacts of abolishing the capital gains tax are 1.3 million people having jobs for the first time because of the capital gains abolition. You expand the tax base of the U.S. and you're actually going to increase government revenue, not just an offset, but an actual increase of up to 1.2% is what the Stewart card quantifies that as, specifically because of the abolition of capital gains tax. Okay. So in that third contention, you talk about income inequality. So do any of these cards actually say capital gains taxes being reduced or even abolished contribute to income inequality, or do you take two numbers and kind of like extrapolate them out?
Actually, so what we see with the 2011 report from the Congressional Research Service, they found that a 1% increase in capital gains income results in a 0.1% increase in the Gini coefficient, which is a measure of economic inequality.
Could we get that 2011 card?
Yes.
All right. I think it's your question.
All right, so when in the past have we reduced capital gains tax rates and saw an increase in investment?
Sure. Well, we can point to three specific examples, and Landon will bring up the actual card in his rebuttal, but we can look to 1981, 1997, and 2013. In every one of those cases, we saw government revenues increase 15 to 25% specifically because of capital gains reductions. So the complete abolishment of the tax is going to get us all these kinds of benefits that we point out. We're going to get $8 billion in research and development, 1.3 million jobs being created, increase in productivity, decrease the unemployment rate, increase the GDP, and just benefit the Americans the most. That's the reason why the judges should be voting pro in today's round. Okay. In that subpoint B, you talk about South Carolina. So is this one state example the only place we've seen capital gains taxes like working? Or is it the only place where we've seen a reduction and the only harm you can point to? Is one state and one specific example?
Actually, no. We have other cards that my partner will bring up in rebuttal from 2001 and also 2003. But we just picked the South Carolina evidence specifically because it showed exactly where the benefits were flowing to. And then also it was the most recent we could find.
All right. Sounds good. And if we could get that 2011 card.
There you go. Just follow the arrows on it.
We'll run prep time.
Okay, that starts now.
Are all three of my judges ready? Sounds good. Opponents?
Yep.
Awesome. All right, so let's first look at my opponent's first contention. What's key here is they're talking about how there's a disproportionate effect that capital gains taxation has if you abolish it. Their subpoint A looks at the consolidation of wealth in the top income brackets. Three problems here. First, realize they assume that because the top income brackets are the ones paying the capital gains tax, that the benefits of cutting the capital gains tax end there. That's not true. That's why Sinai tells us in 2010 that if you abolish the capital gains tax, you would create 1.3 million jobs every single year. To argue that that would only go to the top 10% of income earners is like ignoring the fact that these jobs are being created for lower and middle class families. On top of that, you're seeing 0.23 percentage point increase in GDP annually. These benefits are key and they extend past just the wealthiest 20%. But second, realize that historically, we've seen successes with cutting the capital gains tax. That's what PolitiFact tells us in 2013, finding that the three major times we've cut capital gains taxes, 1981, 1997, and 2003, we've seen overall investment rise by 15 to 25%. That's key because when investment rises, you create jobs, you increase wages, and you see a rise in overall government income. That's our third main response, and that's the increase in revenue. What's really important here is how the Cato Institute tells you in 1995 that if you abolish the capital gains tax, you would actually see an increase in $3,000 available to each household in America. That's really important because these are benefits that extend far greater than just the top income earners, and to say that it stops at them is only looking at a very binary analysis of the resolution. But moving to their subpoint B, they talk about how it's an empirical failure. Two problems here. First, realize they're just talking about how it was a failure. They're saying like it only benefits the top percent. The first problem here is that they're not looking at state-specific taxes. Those are like different. We're looking nationally. We're looking at the effects of capital gains taxes on a national level, not state-specific examples. But second, realize that nationally, the case is far different than what they show you in South Carolina. That's what PolitiFact again tells us in 2013, that when you cut capital gains taxes, you see rises in investment. But furthermore, Strulich quantifies this in 2012, saying that if you abolish the capital gains tax, you would increase overall government revenues by 0.3 to 1.2%. And if that's not enough, the Wall Street Journal further quantifies in 2007 that abolishing the capital gains tax would increase state output by 18%. Moving to their second contention, they're talking about tax shelters. Two problems here. First, they don't quantify it. They just say tax sheltering and tax avoidance is bad, but they don't show you how bad it is or how it gets worse in a pro world. And second, they don't give you an impact. They don't tell you why this is a bad thing. They assume it's a bad thing, but because they don't quantify it and because they don't link into it, there's no way for Hayden and I to weigh it. But moving to their third contention, they talk about an increase in inequality. Their subpoint A looks specifically at the quality of life. All they're saying here, though, is that income inequality is a bad thing, and we're not going to disagree with them there. But the problem is they don't even link into income inequality. They never show you that capital gains taxes lead, or abolishing the capital gains tax would lead to an increase in income inequality. And until they show that, there's no way for them to make this argument. So moving to their subpoint B, they talk about mortality. It's just an impact of their contention. What they're saying here is that because capital gains link into the Gini coefficient, and the Gini coefficient links into mortality rates, that they link into mortality. The problem is this is a very long link chain, and it can be broken in a few places. First, realize they don't link into the Gini coefficient because they don't show you that when you abolish the capital gains tax, that you actually increase income inequality or on the Gini coefficient. And second, they don't show you how capital gains specifically and the abolition of that would lead to an increase in mortality or an increase in mortality rate. What Hayden and I show you is you create jobs, you increase research and development spending, and you grow the economy. But moving to the pro side of the flow, pull through our first contention on economy, subpoint A, investment. Marotta makes it clear that because people are avoiding the capital gains tax as it is, it's better to get rid of it, unlock investment, and spur growth, which is what our subpoint B talks about, specifically looking at what Sinai tells us in 2010, finding that abolishing the capital gains tax creates 1.3 million jobs annually and grows the GDP by 0.23 percentage points annually. But furthermore, Strulich tells you in 2012 that you increase government revenues as well by 0.3 to 1.2%. And finally, on the unjust taxation, this hurts workers. For these reasons, we urge you to affirm.
Yeah, can I get you guys evidence from the facts?
Yep.
Okay, brief off-the-clock roadmap. I'm going to touch on my opponent's case and come back to ours. That being said, are my judges ready? Okay, opponents?
Yeah.
And partner?
Yeah.
Perfect. Starting the first contention about increasing the economy, there's some point out investment. Two problems here. First, capital gains tax cuts make startup investment less productive. Berman finds in September of 2012 that cutting the tax leads to capital being steered away from productive investments into relatively unproductive uses simply because they generate huge tax benefits, draining capital away from other more productive investments. And the Bach card that they cite in their case finds in April of 2017, right after they stop citing the card, that the results concerning the effect on the probability of success of startups shows that a higher tax burden is associated with a higher probability of eventual startup success. Therefore, they're not giving you the big picture with their Bach card. They're telling you that we have an increase in investments. Sure. but they're far less productive. Therefore, because a good investment is a productive investment, my opponents have far less productive investments, and rather you buy Berman and the rest of the bot card, tell me that the con side has more productive investments, that's where we get the advantage to vote con. Then they talk about venture capital. Another response here. Berman finds in September of 1997 that much of the funds for venture capital come from sources that do not pay capital gains taxes and so would not be affected by cuts, end quote. The Washington State Budget and Policy Center finds in 2017 that this figure is 88% of all venture capital firms, showing that they have no link into increased investment through venture capital. Then they talk about economic growth in their subpoint B. Two big problems here. First, economic growth is overstated. San Chirico, the director of the Center of Tax Law and Policy at UPenn, finds in February 2013 that attempting to spur economic growth with tax preferences for capital income may be like trying to repair one side of the roof with shingles from the other. And the literature is quite clear that there's no consensus that decreasing the capital gains tax increases economic growth. Rather, our second response proves otherwise through historical precedent. Gale finds in February of 2016 that the 2001 tax cut raised the cost of capital for investments in residential housing and corporate structures, showing that they actually got the opposite of what my opponents were trying to get. It increased the cost of capital, which decreases investment. Yagan from California Berkeley examines in December of 2015 that the 2003 dividend tax cut, one of the largest reforms ever to U.S. capital tax rate, caused zero change in corporate investment and employee compensation, end quote, thus showing that when you look to the past, which my opponents do not do, you see no increase in investment and no increase in employee compensation, and that's how you don't get economic growth from my opponents' case. Then they talk about the Sinai evidence, how the very Sinai report our opponents cite from September 2010 predicts that at a 20% capital gains rate compared with the current 15%, real economic growth falls by 0.05% per annum and jobs decline 231,000 a year. This fits with our opponents' story. Of course, the capital gains tax rate is now 23.8%, higher than the predicted amount, but the impact is nowhere to be seen. Wood writes in April 2014 that the tax started on January 1st, 2013. However, according to Lam in January of 2017, the U.S. has experienced 75 consecutive months of job growth. Therefore, the prediction of our opponent's study is trying to make does not agree with what we have seen in the real world, and this casts serious doubt on the validity of their claim going the other way. Let's go to their second contention, talking about how the tax is unjust through the double taxation. There are major problems here. Sanghui finds in September of 2012 that many companies, especially the biggest ones, rarely pay full taxes on their income due to the vast variety of tax loopholes and credits available to them, and as a result, the problem of double taxation is often overblown and more of a convenient myth than a reality, showing that my opponents don't have a clear link to any of their impacts, because really, the double taxation is just a rhetorical ploy that my opponents are trying to use without any actual real impact on the average American. Rather, you look to our Hungerford card, which tells you that 90% of capital gains accruals go to the top 20% of earners. Therefore, this impacts the wealthy the most, not the middle class, like my opponents are trying to tell you happens. Therefore, you just get the more impacts in our contention three, which are far more unjust. We cannot have a decreased quality of life and an increased mortality rate at the expense of the American people. Therefore, we turn to our case. The response to our first contention, subpoint A, their Sinai card, reply that response. Their Sinai prediction was proved wrong in the 2013 taxes increase. Therefore, they can't carry that on right now. We need to look to the past. Then they talk about PolitiFact. However, they're talking about investment income revenue, which would not exist if you abolish the capital gains tax. Therefore, their card isn't exactly talking about what they want to talk about. And then the third response is the revenue. Again, this is purely hypothetical. We need to look to the past and see that investment income and employee compensation did not increase with the 2003 or the 2001 tax cuts. They respond to our subpoint B with the same exact responses, so flow that. And this is state specific, but states are the testing grounds for government policy, thus it is valid. And we urge you to come out.
All right, so you bring up this example of South Carolina in your rebuttal and both in your case, and you're saying that you look at states as a testing ground for federal budget policy, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so can we at least agree that like the way that state taxes work is fundamentally different than federal taxes?
That's not entirely true. The capital gains tax taxes like capital assets or investments.
Okay.
It's the same thing that's taxed by the federal government.
So is it better to look at a one state example or three federal examples?
Well, I mean, there's no real preference either way because it's a sufficient, like, sample size.
Wait, it's a federal, we're talking about the federal tax policy, right?
Yeah, like, Gallup polls. So is it not better to look at? Like, Gallup polls ask, like 1,000 people,
okay.
And that's representative of the entire U.S. population. So clearly, one out of 50 U.S. states is sufficient.
So South Carolina is sufficient to predict economic effects of a tax policy on the entire United States?
Yeah, and
okay.
If you don't believe that, you can look to the 2001 and the 2003, and I would like your question. So you respond to our contention, too, by basically asking us for the impact and the quantification.
Yeah.
But if the wealthy have the possibility of paying 0% on all of their taxes, like, isn't that a clear enough impact?
Right, but you don't quantify it. You don't say, you don't give us a probability, you don't give us a time frame, you don't give us a breaking point. There's no way for us to wait. You're just saying tax
time frame
is bad.
The time frame is immediately
after. So, like, what's the impact? Like, what happens? What's the, like, how many people does this affect?
Okay, so you guys, don't dispute the link, right?
Well, you don't really prove, you just suggest there's a link between capital gains and tax sheltering, but you don't actually show there's an increase. You don't
actually, we do.
Okay, what's the quantification then? You abolish capital gains tax, how much does tax sheltering go up by?
Quantification isn't necessary for every argument we try to make.
But it's necessary for that one.
It's not actually. When you look to what's happening right now, the wealthy class is converting their income from labor income to capital gains income, and if you tax that at a 0% rate, of course they're going to have a 0% tax on all of their income.
Okay, you can like make that argue like warrant that argumentatively, but you have to also like link it with evidence that suggests it would actually happen.
And that's what Aaron does. You can have a question.
Who, Aaron who?
From the Brookings Institute.
Can I get that he says if you abolish the capital gains tax, it'll actually lead to an increase in tax sheltering? Because if he doesn't say that, then it's not what your argument is.
Okay, you can have a question.
Okay, you talk about this issue with mortality rate. What if we cut capital gains taxes and seen mortality increase as a result of capital gains tax?
Or evidence doesn't specifically date any sort of like historical example.
So how many people die if we cut the capital gains tax?
Well, that's a really hard prediction to make, but what we do tell you is that a 1% increase in capital income, which would happen under your guys' side, an even greater increase in capital income.
So what happens? Do we increase capital income or do we not? Because you said
no, you increase capital income because it's not being taxed.
Okay, but you're also increasing investment, which increases capital income, right?
Well, yes, but that's a separate question. What we're talking about is that if you increase capital income, you increase inequality, and that's been proven.
Right, but your evidence doesn't say if you abolish capital gains rate, you actually increase inequality.
Yes, it does.
Because
if you abolish the capital gains tax, people can take home more capital.
Okay, income. Can I get the evidence that says that abolishing the capital gains tax increases income inequality?
Sure.
Okay.
So what card is that?
I don't know. You said you had it, though.
So that's the argument we're trying to make?
I gave you guys the CRS card, right?
Yeah.
Like, this is it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll run back then.
All right, you have 49 seconds left. It starts now.
Judges ready? Opponents ready?
Yep.
All right. Okay, first starting off on that point of the economy, we really have to be looking at two things here. First is on the theory that both teams present, specifically on investment in general. What Ben did is he basically just addressed the Bach and Watzinger card, but he ignores the Morota card from 2014, the Heritage card from 2001, the Alan Greenspan card from 2001, and the Joint Economic Committee card from 1997, showing a wide swath of time, all agreeing on the exact same thing. The capital gains taxes act as a barrier to investment and as barriers to innovation in the U.S. economy in the status quo. The only way to knock down these barriers is all of those sources say, is to eliminate the capital gains tax. It's also the same thing that the Small Business Council, which Ben also did not address, says say the exact same thing, that the preferable solution is the elimination of the capital gains tax, and the Lehman card from the Fraser Institute agrees, saying that it diminishes the reward for entrepreneurial risk-taking. The only way to diminish these risks and really exacerbate the rewards is to be voting pro in today's round. Also on the growth point, they never touched the Salter nor the Strula card, which tells us about $8 billion in research and development funding, and the 1.2% increase in government revenue, all of which could satisfy a lot of the harms that Ben and Victoria talk about in their case. They try to indict the Allen Sinai card, but never do they give us an actual piece of evidence for that. Ben simply gives his opinion on the card. Second, we're talking about unjust taxation and really fairness in general. Our opponents really try and link into income inequality in today's round, but never do they show a specific link between capital gains taxes themselves and like the abolition or the lowering of them and the increase in income inequality. They simply string some numbers together and expect us to paint a picture. However, Landon and I give you everything we need talking about capital gains tax, and Ben never addresses the Carroll card in February of 2012, which talks about how the capital gains tax lowers America's quality of life and standard of living simply because of its existence. So at the end of the round today, you're looking at two things. First, on the economy. All the harms that Ben and Victoria point out exist in their world, exist in the status quo. The only way to eliminate these harms is by voting pro in today's round. And second, we talk about fairness. The only way to change the status quo, to change the rising income inequality in the United States, is through the abolition of the capital gains tax. Only Landon and I do that, and that's why you should be voting pro in today's round.
Yeah, we'll take a bit.
All right, and it starts now.
Judges ready? Opponents?
Yeah.
Partner?
Yep.
Okay. There are two main voters in this round, the first being economy and the second being inequality. So to the first voter of economy, we are winning on this for two main reasons. The first being investment. Our opponents claim throughout their entire case that with the abolishment of the capital gains tax, there would be soaring increases in investment. However, if you look to our Berman card, while there may be some sort of increase in investment, there actually are less productive investments created, which are less beneficial to the economy as a whole. And then if you look to our bot card as well, which they cited in their own case, they just did not read the full citation, that if you have a higher tax burden, there is greater success in these startup companies. And so if they're on the con side, there is a higher capital gains rate than on the pro side. And so there is greater success produced from these startup companies, and that would benefit the economy far more than less successful startup businesses would. And so if you're voting on investment, you will be voting for the con side. And then to the second reason we are winning on economy is historical precedent. So we state our Gale card that in 2001 there was a tax cut and prices of stocks actually increased, which is against what the pro is advocating for. So if you're voting on that, you're voting for the con. And also look to our Yagen card that in 2003 after they cut the capital gains effective rate, there was no change. There was no increase in investment. None of these impacts that the pro is claiming will happen actually did happen. And they say this PolitiFact card that's trying to say that there was an increase in investment. However, that was just an increase in investment income revenue, and obviously that investment income revenue would not exist in a pro world because the capital gains tax would not exist as well. And so if you're voting on economy, you're voting for the con. And then to inequality, we provide direct links from the capital gains tax to increases in the Gini coefficient. And the Gini coefficient is a measure of income inequality. And so if you see an increase in the Gini coefficient, that means inherently that there is an increase in income inequality, which leads to all of the harms of decreased quality of life and increased mortality rate that we state within our case and have pulled through up to this point. So I urge a con ballot.
Okay, so where in your guys' historical precedent do you saw the causality between a decrease in the capital gains tax rate and an increase in income inequality or in like economic harms? Where do you show the actual causality of this?
Well, for income inequality, that comes from the South Carolina card where 96% of the benefits went to the top 20% of earners.
Did that lead to an increase in income inequality or just an increase in concentration of wealth? Like, what was the actual impact?
That's the same. That's the same.
So what was the impact? What happened?
The impact is increased economic inequality.
But like, what happened there? Like, what happened in South Carolina?
96% of the benefits
went
to the top
20%.
Did
a bunch of people start dying because of an increased mortality rate as a result of the increase in income inequality?
Well, Zeng would contend that that link does exist, yes.
But
okay,
it's
but
just
did
not
it happen?
Evidence.
Like, one person contending that it could happen and it never happens historical with precedents, then there's no reason
okay,
to
if you guys want to ignore that card, that's fine.
Okay.
But we also have other historical precedents from 2001 and 2003.
Right, so your stock price point there, what was the causality there?
No, it's not about the stock. Wait, what stock price?
Your 2001 example.
No, right. The 2001 said that it raised the cost of capital, and that's
right.
A huge barrier to investment.
Right?
Right,
and Victoria just said in summary that it led to a decrease in the stock value.
Okay,
so,
well,
like, what actually
evidence,
happened?
The evidence says that it raised the cost of capital.
Okay, so what was the causality there?
I mean, you can ask Gail.
Okay.
Right, you guys have a question?
Yeah, we do. So you talk about this, you continue to bring up the Sinai card, and you
mm-hmm.
say that my indict of that card was just my opinion. But
it was.
Like when I was citing the card itself.
Right.
Okay, so like I cited the Sinai card itself, I cited Wood in 2014 who said that there was an increased tax in 2013, and then Lam who wrote in January 2017 that
mm-hmm.
there have been 75 consecutive months of job growth, thus disproving Sinai's prediction.
So it how didn't, can you it didn't say it just proves an ice projection. You're combining, like, you're linking two pieces of evidence there.
If there's well, been
but
growth
it doesn't,
and
you, have
no,
you don't have a specific critique of Sinai's
well,
analysis.
I can explain it again. Sinai said
right,
that
no, like, I understand your explanation there, but okay. Unless you have a direct critique of Alan Sinai's macroeconomic model, then you're just implying
well,
that it may
if,
be wrong.
If it was disproven by the 2013 tax increase, then
wait, it was
why would it apply now?
I don't know what you mean by it was disproven.
Because,
it predicted
okay, so the Sinai card tells you that if you increase the capital gains tax rate,
right.
You'll see job declining. However,
right,
when it was increased in 2013, we saw job growth for 75 consecutive months.
But unless you're specifically showing that the Sinai analysis is wrong based off his macroeconomic model, which is what you, which was used to see the impacts of an abolition, then at that point you're just trying to critique the warrant there. But it's
yep.
Just your opinion.
All right, we'll take a question. So
a
you guys talked about Barclay in 2003. He talks about we saw a 0% increase in corporate investment. But during that same year in 2003, we saw a 15 to 25% increase in government revenue. So wouldn't we see that, like, on a whole, we saw a positive impact
yeah.
to the economy because of a reduction in the capital gains
tax
rate?
Could I ask what tax that government revenue came from?
Right, so what the
PolitiFact investment income revenue. That's taxed by
the
capital gains, right?
What the PolitiFact article points out is that in 1981, 1997, and 2003, what
yeah.
revenues increased was the income coming to investors rose by 15 to 25%.
That's not true.
You called for the card if you want to see it again. How much prep time do we have left?
1 second.
All right.
You gonna need that, Landon?
Yeah. All right. Are all three of my judges ready? Awesome. Opponents?
Yep.
Okay. So looking at the first main voting issue of the round, the economy. What's important here is Morota makes it clear in 2014 that 50% of capital gains go untaxed in the status quo. This is an unprotected tax that leads to bad investment. That was never responded to in the round. But furthermore, remember the Heritage Foundation and the Joint Economic Committee found the greatest barrier to investment in the status quo is the presence of a capital gains tax, again, unresponded to. Furthermore, Sinai tells you in 2010 the ultimate impacts of abolition of the capital gains tax. First, you see 1.3 million jobs created every single year, as well as a 0.23 percentage point increase in GDP annually. That's key because their only response there is he tries to delink Sinai, saying his other predictions were wrong, but he never provides you with the specific critique that says the Sinai macroeconomic model is wrong. At that point, it still stands. But if you do choose to drop it, remember that Harvard tells you in 2014 that you still increase research and development spending by $8 billion over the next 5 years, and Strulich tells you in 2012 that you increase government revenues by 0.3 to 1.2 percentage points, and that went cold drop throughout the round, but it's the most important card because it shows that overall government revenues rise on a national level with abolition. That provides us the most benefits for the most people. But furthermore, remember the Wall Street Journal tells us in 2007 that if you abolish the capital gains tax, you would also increase state output by 18%, which is why PolitiFact writes in 2013 that the three major times we've cut capital gains taxes, we've seen income from investments rise every single time. But moving to the second main voting issue of fairness, remember what Carol tells you in 2012 and my opponents never respond to, and that's that issue of double taxation leads to a decrease in wages and a decrease in quality of life for workers. Furthermore, the Cato Institute quantifies this finding that if you did abolish the capital gains tax rate, you would see an increase in revenue to families by $3,000 for every American family. That was never responded to. These are the most benefits for the most people in this round. But finally, remember, their only really point here is income inequality. But the problem is they don't even link into it. They don't show you that if you abolish the capital gains tax, that income inequality goes up by any amount, and if it does, they don't show you how it's ever happened historically or what the ultimate impact of it is. At that point, there's no reason to be voting for them, but you do have the issues of the economy and overall fairness. It's why Hayden and I urge you to affirm.
How much prep time does...
You have a minute left.
Oh, sweet, we'll use it.
All right, start standing. Thank you.
All right, brief off-the-clock roadmap. I'm going to touch on the two main voters in today's round. With that being said, are my judges ready? Are my opponents ready?
Yeah.
And is my partner ready?
Yeah.
Perfect. Starting voter of the economy. My opponents have completely dropped our Bach and Berman card. Although they carry the Bach card through their case, they neglect to talk about the site that they don't continue to cite, which is that a higher capital gains tax is associated with an increase in startup success. At the same time, Berman tells you in 2012 that a decrease in the capital gains tax causes investments to be less productive because investors just want to get a tax break instead of actually making productive investments. Therefore, the con side gives you the most responsible form of economic growth, and because they don't argue this, they can't get any benefits from their increase in investment, which is the driving force of their entire first contention. Therefore, because increased investments are not beneficial to the economy, because just increased investments by itself without having more productive investments is not beneficial, or the pro side is not beneficial at all. At the same time, the PolitiFact article that they continue to bring through just talks about revenue from investment income. The capital gains tax is the only thing that taxes this, and therefore if you abolish it, there's zero there. Therefore that turns the other point, actually. And then their Sinai card is invalid because its prediction of a decrease in jobs from an increase in the tax was proven wrong by the CGT increase in 2013. We've had some 75 consecutive months of job growth, and that takes out the predictive capability of their Sinai study. At the same time, Gale and Yagan tell you about both in 2001 and 2003 that there was no increase in investment or employee compensation. They have yet to deal with that fact that historical precedents reign supreme in today's round. And at the same time, their government revenue point is contingent on investment, and because it's unproductive, there's no increase in revenue there. Let's go to our second main voter, which is inequality. Our opponents completely drop our second contention. Instead, they only try to fiddle around with like saying that we don't have an impact. The impact is quite clear. If we allow the millionaire and billionaire class to keep converting their income from labor income to capital gains income and have it taxed at a 0% rate, that's going to increase income inequality. It doesn't take a quantification or number to figure this out. And at the same time, they drop our contention three, talking about the impacts of inequality. They more importantly drop our Seven Pillars Institute, telling you that all of these negative impacts on our subpoint A and then the subpoint B of the mortality rate, if we increase capital income, which would happen with them, we'd increase mortality rate. Thus, we urge a con ballot.